Now, as I was wet sanding the tail section here with the first coats of primer on, I was thinking about how that rudder pin attaches or gets kept once you put the rudder on, drop the pin in. I knew there was a little piece broken off here, and I assumed that it just stopped right there. So I just had ferreted in and rounded it off. But I finally found a picture of what the tail end looks like. And you can see there's a little tang that sticks out here where the pin drops into. Then there's a little tail skid bump here, which I guess acts as a tail skid and keeps the tail off the ground a little bit. But you can see on my plane here, that's totally missing. So I'm gonna have to fabricate a new piece and try to fix that and have something for that pin to drop into. So what I did was I first cut away some of the plastic here and made a little shelf and used a piece of plywood and glued a little square piece on as long as the back of the rudder here and correct width, and I can sand that to shape. Now this is okay strong, but it's probably not going to hold up to strong landings, plus I still want to get a skid here. So the next step is I'm going to cut a slot for a tail skid. I'm going to use a piece of carbon here. I'm going to cut a slot in here, and that'll join the plywood piece with the main fuselage here and bridge that gap, and that's going to add a lot more strength to this little piece here and give a firm foundation for that pin. And then I'm going to get myself, you know, a nice trick little tail skid here, and this will stick out about halfway. So here's the skid mounted in. You can see it goes full depth, so it ties in the back of the fuse molding here with the plywood piece, and the carbon goes just full depth down in here. So this piece is really glued firmly to the skid and the skid firmly to the fuse here. Now the pin can come down and rest and get stopped by this piece, and none of these pieces are going to tear off. I'm going to add a little bit of putty, clean this up, fair it up, and shoot some more primer on it. Get this thing ready for primary paint. Now here's the fuse. It's been wet sanded within an inch of its life. I used 220 and 320 wet and dry. And I've done three passes with white spot putty filler to fill in some of the small flaws. Like, remember, we had the on-off switch here. Got that filled in and ferreted out really nice. One of the big problems was the seam between the plastic and the fiberglass fuse here. While you couldn't really see it, you ran your finger over here, there was quite a bit of a divot all the way around here. So I took a couple of passes of filler to get that filled in, get that smoothed out. Also, the area around where I put in the new tube, I found that there was a surface crack here too. You couldn't see it initially until I started sanding it, and it was loose and a little bit crumbly, so I used some CA to fill that up. And then again, three passes to fill the basic flaws. One thing you'll find out about the Hobies is that the fuse mold here is pretty rough. There's lots of low and high spots, and you're not gonna be able to fill and fair that out. But if you use a light color, it's not gonna show up that much. And in the back, also the seam between the fuse and the plastic tail cone piece was a little rough too. And you can see I filled that with the filler again. Only use the filler for really shallow spots. Use auto body filler for the deeper spots. So took a ton of wet sanding here, 320, 220, and again, three passes here. I'm gonna shoot some of the white primer on it now, and that's gonna show all the flaws that I missed. You can see I cleaned up the tray cutout area too and filled in some of these ugly holes too. So I'm gonna shoot that with the white primer, and I'll show my flaws. Probably do one or two more passes with filler and a lot more wet sanding, then it's gonna be ready for the final paint. Now here's the primer I'm going to use. This is one of my favorite primers. This is automotive type primer, but it's a Rust-Oleum brand. I get this at my local Walmart pretty easily. And this is really light because it is primer. It's much lighter than, say, gloss white paint or a flat white regular paint. So I'm going to shoot this, wet sand, wet sand, wet sand. Once everything's perfect, I'm going to shoot a final coat or two of this and then shoot an automotive clear coat over the top of that. And that's going to be my final paint. It's a lot lighter than gloss white paint, and it's easier to fix too if you have to do any repairs later. Now here's a clear coat I'm going to use, Rust-Oleum brand as well. This is an acrylic lacquer. This is automotive grade, so it's not going to yellow in the sun like a lot of clear coats you buy in a craft store will do. This will be nice and light. I'm going to do a little test section here too, but I'm pretty sure this is lacquer based as well, and they should be compatible with each other. But you know, if you're going to use a lacquer based acrylic, always do a small test section over your paint because it may wrinkle the paint out. Well, the paint job is all finished, and I just used the white flat primer as my color coat on this, and then shot three coats of clear acrylic automotive grade primer. I'll show you the can of that to get the gloss here. This is very lightweight and it'll be easy to repair as well. So if I have any cracks or I need to do a repair on the piece, it's very easy to repair and touch up this sort of system of using the flat color with an automotive clear coat over the top. Turned out really nice. I did wet sand between the white coats to get everything smooth because, you know, the primer shows up a lot of flaws. Here's how the tail turned out with the little extra skid here where I had to replace the back hold down piece, which was broken off. But looks brand new. You don't see any seam lines. And it's ready for a radio install. Now, since I'm using a Zepsus magnetic switch to turn the airplane on and off so I can keep the canopy on, I needed to have some sort of charging jack. And I got this idea from one of the other Hobie guys is doing a hidden jack. So when the wing's on, the wing root hides where the jack is externally. This is a female JST connector, and I just cut a small slot and embedded it in there. And I'm going to have to make a male-to-male pigtail adapter so I can plug this into my chargers, but this is a slick way to be able to check your voltage and do charging without having to take the canopy on and off. Now that the fuse is painted, it's ready for the radio install. It's got the 7010 DSMX Spectrum here. It's got Velcro on the back. I'm going to Velcro this to the inside of the fuse. It goes right to the servos here. This is a nice receiver for this because I just need two channels. I have a power connector wired, soldered directly to the receiver, and then it goes to the Zepsus switch here. Now this particular switch actually is a voltage regulator as well, so it takes any incoming voltage and it'll take it down to 5 volts for my servos because these servos don't like higher voltages. So if I don't want to use my 4-cell end of loop pack, I can substitute, say, a lighter 2-cell lithium polymer or lithium ion pack. Now here are the stabs covered, and this is the Ultra Coat Light transparent red color. Remember I did the black, flat black undercoat on the wood here, and it turned out okay. The silhouette effect really works well, but the Ultra Coat Light is very, very, very thin, and while it's okay for the stabs, I don't think it's going to be okay for the wing. So I made a decision to go with just a regular Ultra Coat and some opaque colors, because while it went on okay, and if you want to learn how to put this stuff on, there's lots of good videos online. I'm not the best in the world to put this stuff on, but it wasn't super hard. The problem I was having is, remember, I painted these with flat black paint. I don't know if you can see on this part right here. But even though I kept my iron about 240, which is about the lowest temp you want for the adhesive to stick, the paint was starting to get weird and interacting with the adhesive on the Ultra Coat strangely. Even though I did a test, you know, once I really got the heat on it, it kind of acted weird. So you can see it's a little bit splotchy. From 10 feet away, you can't really see it, but I really don't want to commit and put this thin stuff on the wings because the wings have the same flat black paint color, but it came out okay. I'm probably going to change my mind at some point and strip the covering off and recover these one more time with maybe some opaque color, but they look all right. And for my first covering job in quite a number of years, that looks pretty good. If you've enjoyed this video, please support my work by purchasing some of my full-length training and how-to videos, which cover a wide variety of RC soaring subjects, including building, tuning, radio programming, and repair. Go to radiocarbonart.com to browse our growing library of instructional DVDs and high-quality digital downloads on all facets of soaring. While at my site, check out my blog, where you can read more about this restoration project and other interesting RC soaring subjects. Go to radiocarbonart.com.